So good morning and greetings to the guests and members ng Bonds of Love Christian Ministries. And today po marks our 25th anniversary of BLCM, and we celebrate God's grace, especially po dito to this local church here sa Laguna. But in the last 2 years po, mula noong 2020 and 2021, hindi po naging madali sa atin lahat, no, yung mga taon na ito. And all of us are praying, no, for especially this morning, na we will start, no, a fresh na zeal in our hearts of this church and its congregation in our worship to God. And especially po yung we calibrate our focus on the call of Jesus Christ to discipleship. Ngayong araw din po na ito is the first virtual worship service of Bonds of Love Christian Ministries. And kami din po ay nagpapasalamat sa Diyos for setting everything up perfectly for our pioneer na run dito po sa ating virtual worship service. Especially po yung mga darating pa po na worship service in the near future. A lot of things po are indeed worth celebrating sa araw na ito. But now, let me take a serious turn here and put on a serious tone as we approach God's Word here today. As with this as our start ng bagong taon ng ating iglesia, we want to start it sa in a very serious look in Scripture. At ako po'y naniniwala that this message will hit the mark kung ano po ba yung pangangailangan ng ating iglesia ngayon, no? When I mean church, Bonds of Love Christian Ministry. Especially going forward for the years to come. I invite everyone po, no, to please stop what you are doing as a distraction today. If you are eating, stop it. If you are on your mobile phones, please stop it as well. If you are distracted of any sort of activity right now, stop it. Because what God has in store in us for sa araw na ito are things of great importance, seriousness, and may tono po ng authority. Ilagay po ninyo ang Biblia where it needs to be placed, which is in your hands. Place your ears and your hearts and yung inyong pong punong attention or your full attention sa ating pong pag-uusapan sa araw na ito. I know we are celebrating today, but the message that is in store for us, I hope, will make us take things very seriously. O seseryosohin po natin ang mga bagay-bagay. From year 26 and onwards in our life as a church. So I invite you to take your Bibles, kunin po natin ang ating mga Biblia, and turn with me to the book, to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 14. And babasahin ko po yung ating paseo for this morning in Luke chapter 14, beginning verse 25. Ang titulo po ng mensahe na to is, The Cost of Following Christ. Beginning in verse 25 of Luke chapter 14. Ito po ang inspired Word of God. Walang mali at hindi nagkakamali na salita ng ating Panginoon. So take heed. Luke 14 verse 25 to 35. I'll babasahin ko po sa Ingles at I hope the brethren also can read it in Filipino. Now great crowds accompanied him, and he turned and said to them, If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, and wife, and children, and brothers, and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it. Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, "This man began to build and was not able to finish." Or what king going out to encounter another king in war will not sit down first and deliberate what he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any one of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Back in my college days po, ako po ay naglaro ng, I played soccer for De La Salle das Marinas. At ako po ay nag-represent ng probinsya ng Cavite sa mga regional competition. That was one point in my career as an athlete. Unfortunately po, ang soccer or football, hindi po non-scholar po yan na sport sa aming eskwelahan. So, ibig sabihin po, meron po akong konting freedom na meron po ako habang po ako yung naglalaro. Since yung universidad ay binayaran lamang po ang aking uniforme at ang aking coach. And of course, yung equipment na ginagamit namin habang kami ay nag-eensayo. But I had to train still. Kailangan ko pa rin mag-ensayo, no? Yung aking pong schedule nung ako po yung nag-eensayo is nag-uumpisa ng 5 o'clock in the morning. I had to run 40 na paikot-ikot across the oval at 5 a.m. in the morning. And I had to finish it before 7 a.m. Since yung klase ko po, nag-uumpisa ng 7:30 a.m. I had to go to class and bumalik sa training at 5 p.m. And the finish training around 7 o'clock p.m. Ngunit po, I was not required to do all of this since hindi naman po ako binayaran ng isang scholarship. Ako lang po ay nagko-compete for a spot na hindi lamang po ako mabangko. But during this time, we trained with the athletics na team, or yung track and field na varsity, who were full scholars during that time. And sila po ay nagtitrain para sa mga competition, meaning they signed a contract ng school. And the school will pay for everything. The moment po na itong mga fellow athletes ko na nakasama signed that contract, it cost them everything. For the next 4 years, yung athletic department ng aming universidad ay binili sila. They were technically slaves of the university. Itong mga atleta belonged to them because binayaran ng universidad yung kanilang scholarship. Kapag ako ay dumating sa oval ng 5 a.m., yung mga sprinters o yung mga nananakbo po in the track and field, ay nandun na po sila at 4 a.m. Sila po ay pawis na pawis na, gasping for air, habang ako po ay nagsistretching pa lamang at kung tutusin, kalahating tulog pa. When we passed by the gym at 12 noon, itong mga atleta na ito, sila din po ay nag-workout already. They were lifting weights sa gitna ng araw na iyon para sila ay makabalik sa kanilang mga klase at 1 p.m. When we go to practice at 5 p.m., nandun na naman po sila lahat. They were an hour earlier than us. Nagpa-practice na po sila at gumagawa na po sila ng mga wind sprints over and over again hanggat po maging satisfied ang kanilang coach. May mga curfews para sa kanila. Yung guardian ng dorm nila sinasabi sa kanila kung anong oras sila matutulog. Sinasabihan din sila kung anong oras sila magigising. May mga grades na kailangan nilang i-maintain. At even po, kung tutuusin, kung paniniwalaan nyo, may mandatory pa nga na misa na kailangan po nilang puntahan. Dahil po, Catholic school ang universidad. May mga physical therapies po sila na free. Yung gym nila was free. Ang lunch, dinner, snacks nila, libre. The dorm was even free. Yung kanilang pag-travel to other places during the competition is free. The trainings were free. Because the school ay binayaran po ang lahat-lahat. They therefore own the athlete and throughout their stay in the university was free. It cost them everything. Dugo, pawis, luha, trips to the hospital kapag sila ay na-injured, trips to the trainer, trips to the doctor na binabalik po yung mga buto nila kapag nababali. It cost the athletes everything. And they had to say no sa marami na sinasabi ng na ginagawa ng mga estudyante. When everyone was saying yes, these athletes had to say no. It cost them yung free time nila. It cost them the pleasures of going to certain activities. And they had to live yung kanilang buhay with a singular purpose because yung universidad ay binigyan ng libreng edukasyon ang mga atletang ito. And in a real way, that's exactly what it is like to be a Christian. Sa pagiging disipulo ni Jesu Cristo, everything has been paid full sa krus ng Kalbaryo. Sabi nga po, in my hands, no price I bring. Simply to the cross I claim. For by grace, you have been saved through faith. And then, that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not as a result of works, lest any man should boast. At the cross of Christ, Jesus paid in full the entirety of my sin and death. And all of those who would ever put their faith and trust in Him. And the moment po na ating pong ibinigay ang ating sarili kay Jesus and receive the free gift or yung invitation of eternal life, we have been bought. Hindi na po natin pagmamayari ang ating sarili. You and I belong to the one na bumili sa atin at Calvary's cross. And for the rest of your life, it will cost you everything. It will cost you ang madaling buhay. It will cost you yung komportableng buhay. It will cost you in being able to do yung mga bagay na gusto nyong gawin. Kung kailan nyo ito gusto gawin, or kung papaano nyo gusto itong gawin. It will cost you yung inyong gamit sa oras. It will cost you yung inyong gamit sa pera. It will cost you even if your own influence. It will cost you yung iyong dating buhay. It will cost you yung dating yung mga kaibigan. It will cost you sakripisyo, submission. You'll even face persecution, physical hardships, tribulations, and maybe even kamatayan or death. It will cost you everything para maging totoong mananampalataya kay Kristo. And these words that Jesus had to say to us in this passage are words that kailangan po nating marinig. Because He says to be a disciple, which means to be a believer in Jesus Christ, in a sense, tayo po ay aalis from a crowd of people. Na ating pong tatalikuran yung ating, tatalikod po tayo sa mundong ito, sa sistema ng mundong ito. And we turn to the Lord Jesus Christ and follow Him. To follow Christ demands po that we take a decisive step of faith. At pinagkakatiwala po natin all that we are to the Lord Jesus Christ and tayo po ay under new management. We now have a new master. And our master is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we no longer have a life na pa ating pong sarili. Ang buhay na meron po tayo ay kay Kristo na. By virtue doon sa presyo na kanyang binili po sa atin sa krus ng Kalbaryo. And there is no one of us here today na libre lang mabuhay kung papaano natin gustong mabuhay. We are under new management. Hindi na po tayo pwedeng mabuhay kung papaano natin gustong mabuhay dahil we are blood-bought, or ang pinambayad po sa atin ay dugo ni Kristo. So pagtingin po natin ng paseo ngayon, it's so clearly highlighted kung ano po ang sinabi ko sa inyo. The key word is found in verse 26, 27, and 33. Disciple. The disciple ay learner or nanumpa ng loyalty, nanumpa ng undivided na allegiance to the Lord Jesus Christ. Ang ginawa po natin is we put Christ above everything else sa ating buhay. Christ is primary and everything else is secondary. Una si Kristo at lahat ng ibang bagay sa ating buhay ay pangalawa lamang. As the word Christian ay hindi pa nga po na-invento until many years later after this event. It will not be until Acts chapter 11 sa Antioch na makikita po, natatawagin po ang mga unang disipulo na Christians. Kung tutuusin po ang word na Christian ay word ng pagkutya. Term of paninirang puri po ang word na Christian. The word Christian is a mocking term. Meaning, maliit na Kristo. And ang mundo po nung time na yon, eh, maliit ang pagtingin sa karpintero na ito na galing sa Nazareth. It looked down at this Lord Jesus Christ. And it was an absolute insult to be called a Christian. For the world, ay ipapako si Jesus. But the early believers loved this term. They loved being identified kasama si Kristo. And they embraced this with the term of slander, as a medal of honor, and they love to be called Christians because it identified them with the one who bought them. So as we look at this text, no, I want to make you note several things as we look at this. And I am assuming na marami po sa atin dito na nakikinig are true believers in Jesus Christ. And as I go through this passage, for those who are saying that you are true believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, I just want to remind you what you signed on for. I just want to remind you yung realidad po ng inyong pinasok na ito. The commitment na inyong pinasok na ito. And for the rest of you here today na hindi pa dumating sa punto na ito of a committed life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I can only pray that God will open your eyes, open your ears, so that you will come to see the need that you have today to give your life to Jesus Christ. The first thing I want you to note in verse 25 is the crowds. Grupo o lupon ng mga tao na nagtitipon. In verse 25, makikita nyo po na napakalaking lupon ng tao ang sumusunod kay Kristo. They were going along to Jesus Christ as He was going to, papunta po siya ng Jerusalem. Habang po siya ipapunta sa Jerusalem, ito pong crowds ay dumadagdag ng mga tao. In fact, it says here that crowds is in plural. Crowds with an S. There are usually hundreds, if not thousands, of people who are streaming na lumalabas galing sa kanilang mga sariling bayan. And gusto nilang sumama to dito sa bagong movement na ito, no? Na sumusunod sila sa likod ni Kristo. Narinig nila siyang magsalita. Nakita nila yung mga milagrong kanya pong ginagawa. So, ang nangyari po is parang naakit po itong mga tao na to. Naakit sila and they were just drawn to Jesus Christ. Yung iba po sa kanila is just out of curiosity. Na-curious lang po. Dahil po narinig nila that this Jesus of Nazareth is doing all these things. And others na nandun, they're just want to be there. Instinct po kasi ng tao to be where the crowd is. Isang malaking instinct po natin yan bilang tao. Kung nasa ng mga tao, maraming tao, dun tayo. Hindi po ba, wala naman pong gustong pumasok sa isang restaurant na walang tao. You would want to go to a restaurant na kilala, dinudumog ng tao. Or if may makita po tayong artist or a popular figure, hindi po ba, crowds are easily drawn to popular people, mga artista, mga entertainers, mga politicians. There is no doubt po na may daan-daan na tao na parang na-draw, parang magnet to be part of the crowd. There are others who are there simply because of their religion. And ang tao po kasi is instinctively religious and we wanted to hear more. They wanted to hear more about this person from Nazareth. And then there were others there sa crowd na yon, sa lupon ng mga tao, na mga totoo talaga man na nanampalataya ni Kristo. Alam, kilala natin at least 11 of them from the 100 out of the 12 disciples who were truly believers in Christ. And I want you to see po and to consider gaano kadali maging part ng isang malaking crowd. Napakadali po maging part ng isang religious movement. Napakadali pong sabihin that you are a born-again believer. And it's so easy to be part of Bonds of Love Christian Ministries. That's the easy part. You can blend in. Pwede ka maging anonymous. You can keep your distance. At mas mahirap po kasi maging parte ng isang maliit na grupo because you're exposed. And people can see you, talk to you. Pero pa sa isang malaking crowd, you can just actually hide. Pwede ka pong magtago in a big crowd and not have to fly your allegiance, no? Hindi mo na lang kailangan ipakita yung allegiance and you can sit there, mag-blend in ka na lang. And ito po ang nangyayari dito sa mga large crowds na to nakasama ni Jesus. And we think that's a positive thing na maraming sumusunod kay Kristo. But Jesus Christ has never been after a large crowd. Tandaan po natin, isang malaking lupon ng tao ang magpapako sa krus kay Kristo. Jesus is after disciples. Jesus is not after the quantity, but He's after the quality. Ayaw niya po dun sa dami, ngunit ang mahalaga po sa kanya, yung kalidad at anong klaseng believer ang sumusunod sa kanya. And now, we look at how the drama is unfolding. Habang naglalakad si Kristo, with hundreds behind His back, Jesus suddenly stopped. Huminto si Kristo. As the crowd were coming along, that seemed like a positive thing na maraming kasama si Kristo, huminto si Kristo. Umikot siya at hinarap itong crowd na ito. As He turned to address this crowd, Christ will issue what will now follow some of the strongest words to ever come from the lips of Jesus Christ. Ito po ay isa sa mga pinakamabigat na sasabihin ni Kristo that will come out of His lips. It might be the strongest things that will come out from Jesus' lips. Para sa mga totoong mananampalataya at for those who just want to be part of the crowd or crowd followers. And Jesus, throughout His ministry, tinataasan niya yung standard lagi, tinataasan niya ang demanda lagi, and tinataasan niya na maging absolute at eksklusibo and even extreme. Na ang mga superficial na mananampalataya o mga half-committed Christians begin to drop off. In verse 26, he shows us the commitment nakita na natin yung lupon ng tao. Now, note the commitment. Sasabihin ni Kristo, what is non-negotiable for a Christian? To be a true follower. Brethren, what you will hear today is hindi advanced teaching in Christianity. Hindi po ito advanced teaching in theology. Hindi po ito some sort of advanced Sunday Bible study. This is the most basic. This is the entrance doon sa makitid na gate or in the narrow gate. This is what leads us to the kingdom of heaven. Ito po ang inaasahan upon every single believer. And one, I need to say, hindi po ito itinago ni Kristo sa atin. Hindi niya ito parang ipinasok lang para malito ang isang Kristiyano. But ito po ay iniligay niya sa harap ng marami niyang teachings. And He will put it in front of every one of us, for all of us to see and to understand. Kaysa maging tayo yung builder in the parable na pag-aaralan din natin sa araw na ito, na nagsimula gumawa ng kanyang tower, pero hindi naman niya pala matatapos. So in verse 26, notice Jesus begins, "If anyone comes to me." Now, please note kung gaano ka open arms si Jesus. Kung sino ka man, tagasaan ka man, Hudyo ka man, Hentil, lalaki, babae, kung ano man ang estado mo sa buhay, this is a free offer of the gospel. Whoever will may come. Ang pagpunta kay Kristo is to take that decisive step of faith. Papasukin talaga po natin yung narrow gate and become a true believer in Jesus Christ. And to come to Christ, iiwan po natin lahat. Lahat-lahat. And it's to leave the evil world system behind. Sabi nga po ni Jesus in John 6, chapter 35, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst." To come to Christ is to believe in Christ. Napakarami pa pong verses that I could cite na akin pong pwedeng sabihin and share. But saving faith is never passive. Hindi ka po pwedeng to sit back down in that chair and do nothing, because saving faith is always active at dynamic po. If anyone comes to me, and now he gives the terms. Ang tandaan po ninyo, kung sino ang nag-i-issue ng call of salvation, siya rin po ang magpapatong the terms. Hindi po tayong followers who will set the terms. And I am warning you, I am warning all of us, na hindi po natin pwede i-justify ang ating sarili and isipin po natin na maiintindihan tayo ng Panginoon. So here are the terms. Here is what's necessary o kailangan to come to faith in Jesus Christ. He says, "And does not hate his own father, mother, wife, children, brothers, and sisters." Ano po ito? And many of us here have wives. May fathers po tayo, mothers, brothers, sisters, and children. But is Jesus Christ telling me to hate them? But here po, Jesus clearly says the word hate. At inilagay niya po ito sa negatibo. So that his words actually po will have the shock value. Opo, or magimbal po ang bawat isa sa atin. Or in other words, atakihin po talaga tayo sa puso. And I hope that everyone here today feel the shocking value of the invitation that Jesus is giving. Here, he says, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father, mother, and wife, and children, and brothers, and sisters," ito po yung mga tao who are the very closest to all of us. They're the closest people to us. Maintindihan pa nga po natin kung sabihin ni Jesus, kung magalit po kayo or hate your enemies, I will understand that. But yung mother and father, hindi po ba sabi ng Biblia in the fifth commandment, honor your father and your mother? Well, brothers and sisters, yes, it does. In Exodus 20. And hindi po ba inulit ito in Ephesians chapter 6? Yes, it does. Hindi po ba Jesus on the Sermon of the Mount would say, love your enemies? And Matthew chapter 5. Well, brothers and sisters, yes, he does. And hindi po ba nung siya'y ipinako sa krus, hindi po ba tiningnan niya yung sarili niyang ina and said, son, behold your mother, and mother, behold your son with his dying breath. He was loving his mother and handing her over sa Apostle John so that someone would take a good care or take look after Mary. Hindi po ba does the Bible says that if you don't care of the own members of your own household, mas malala ka pa than an infidel? Well, yes it does. And hindi po ba the Bible never contradicts itself? So, how do we reconcile all of these things? Well, the best interpreter of Scripture is Scripture. So, I want you to turn with me po and go to Matthew chapter 10. And Jesus will be his own interpreter of what he has to say. Matthew chapter 10, verse 37. Jesus says, he who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son and or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Now we understand ang ano sinasabi ni Jesus dito in Luke chapter 14 through the lens of Matthew chapter 10, that what Jesus is saying, hindi siya pwede. He cannot be second place in anyone's life. For a true follower of him, he cannot ride sa likod. You'll just have to find another group, another crowd to get in. Dahil po pag, if we are a true disciple of Jesus Christ, we love him more than anything else this world has to offer. And yung pag-ibig na meron po tayo kay Kristo ay so far, so surpassing na ang pag-ibig po natin for those na pinakamalalapit sa atin, even ang ating mga sariling pamilya, nanay, tatay, mga kapatid, if atin pong ikukumpara sa pag-ibig natin kay Kristo, it would appear as if we hate them. It would appear as if galit pa nga tayo or hindi natin mahal yung ating mga the persons who are closest to us by comparison kung ipaati pong ikukumpara sa pag-ibig natin sa Diyos. Now, I want you to know if mamahalin po natin si Kristo supremely, he will give you a love that will overflow from your for others. And he will pour forth yung kanyang pag-ibig sa ating mga puso with the help of the Holy Spirit. And we will love others. But Jesus says this is the requirement. Ito po yung commitment na kailangan. That gusto niya po, wanting to say to us with the Apostle Paul, for us to live is Christ. Ito po ang suma total and ang sangkap, the substance of what it is to be a Christian. That we love Christ and we follow Christ, that we worship Christ, na sinusunod natin si Kristo, and we follow Christ and we adore Christ. That is what it is to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And it's nice to end the preaching here. Maganda na po, we're done with the preaching in this part. But are you ready po for the knockout punch? Because Jesus, He will not back down. Hindi po siya aatras on what He just said. Hindi po aatras si Jesus sa kanyang sinabi dito. I know anong tunog ng preaching that's like really strong and we have to back out now and be nice in the pulpit. Ngunit po, Jesus will kukunin niya ang sibat and He will trust deeper the spear sa ating puso into the hearts of the listeners. And notice what He says in verse 26. And ipapasok niya po ito deeper. He says, and even His own life. If you love your life more than you love Christ, you cannot. You cannot. You cannot be my disciple. Ang pag-ibig po sa sarili must die. You cannot love Jesus supremely and be caught up with yourselves. You are just busy about everything about yourself. Hindi lang po ito pride. This is not just pride. Well, in one way, it is pride. But ano po ba itsura ng self-love? Self-love looks like this. Pagiging makasarili. Abala sa sarili, pagtaas sa sarili, pagpapalayaw, pagtaguyod sa sarili, pag-una sa sarili, pag-awa sa sarili, inuuna ang sariling kasayahan, pagmayabang sa sarili, pagpapahalaga sa sarili, pagtuon sa sarili, inuubos ang lahat sa sarili, inuuna ang sarili, itinutuon ang mga bagay-bagay sa sarili. And if you say that we want to live for Christ, we cannot live for ourselves. Nor na hindi rin po natin pwedeng ibigin ang ating mga sarili more than Jesus Christ. At sabi niya po in verse 26, He cannot be my disciple if this is the thing. And I want to say it again, this is a non-negotiable attribute. Hindi po marked down yung presyo. Hindi po to discounted. Hindi po ito naka-sale price na pwede po natin itong pababaan. At sinasadya po ni Jesus na maging provocative dito sa crowd na ito, sa araw na ito. Hindi niya po objective na palakihin pa ang crowd. Ang ginagawa po ni Jesus dito is actually He's just trying to divide or He's actually trying to sift down the crowd. Sa realidad po, napakalaki po ng crowd. It was too big. Dahil lang isang crowd na crowd lang, it's never even a congregation. It was just a crowd. So I want to ask you before I go any further po, is this the commitment you have made to Jesus Christ? That you love Christ more than anyone or anything else. That willing ka po na itabi ang mga goals mo sa inyong buhay. Willing ka po itabi ang mga goals mo para sa iyong trabaho. Willing ka itabi ang mga goals mo para sa family mo at ilagay sila lahat secondary to your life and put Christ in the primary. That's why I ask always a challenge to all of you. Ano po yung listahan po ng ano po itsura ng inyong listahan of what you want to accomplish in this life? If the top three of the list in your life, sa listahan po na nasa inyong utak na you want to accomplish in this life, is not anything about Christ, go to God's Word right today na ate pong binabasa at inag-aaralan. What does it look like for you? and for us. I want you to go to the third verse, verse 27, the cross. So, three. Jesus, rather than backing off po, now saying something na mag-i-encourage sa inyo, mag-i-encourage sa atin, mag-build up sa atin, and maging malambot ng konti. So verse 27, Jesus will make one of the most demanding statements na lalabas po sa kanyang bibig. In other words, there is no exception for this. Whoever does not carry his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And this is in the negative po ulit. Napag-aralan niya po natin that you have to put your closest relationships secondary. Kailangan po natin patayin ang self-love and now suffer and carry the cross. Jesus is not wanting to make it easy to follow Him and to paint yung maling litrato sa atin na tayo po ipapasok sa buhay ng sa buhay na madali, lahat ng problema natin ay mawawala. When He said to carry His own cross, hindi pa nga po ito yung cross na sinasabi niya na dadalhin niya dahil hindi pa po namamatay si Jesus. And when He was talking about the cross, if you are a true follower of Jesus Christ, kung ikaw ay tao doong panahon na iyon na nakikinig kay Jesus and parte ka ng Romanong the Empire of Rome, hindi alam ni Jesus na maiintindihan po nila ito. Anong ibig sabihin? Nung unang panahon po, nung panahon na yon, ang krus po ay instrumento ng kamatayan. Ito po ang silya elektrika nung panahon na yon. Ito po yung lethal injection nung panahon na yon. Ito po ang means ng punishment para sa mga guilty. At sa panahon po na yon, there would be charges. May mga hatol po na ibibigay sa isang tao. At kapag dating, pag sinabi ng hukom na guilty, ang gagawin mo po sa iyo is bibigyan ka ng isang parte ng krus na nakakailanganin mong buhatin throughout the streets of the city at ipipilit yun sa iyo, ipo-force ka na dalhin mo yon hanggang sa place kung saan ka mamamatay at saan ka ipapako. Jesus did this through the streets of Jerusalem. And remember po, mga lupon ng tao ay nag-gather at siya'y pinahiya. It was intended to be an open public confession of guilt. Jesus, who was not guilty of anything. And ibig sabihin po nun is that pinapakita ng emperador ng Roma that you are under his authority. And then you are guilty as charged. Hindi po ito piece of rosary or medalya na magandang dalhin. Dahil po ang pagpasan ng krus ay ang pinaka-humiliating, pinaka-mababang punishment that anyone could undergo. And ang sinasabi po ni Kristo dito na you must take up your cross and come after me, He is saying you must acknowledge that you are guilty before God and sinned and short and fallen short of the glory of God. You are now dead to your old way of life. Yung dati mo pong buhay ay patay na. And you are now dead doon sa mga bagay na dati mo pong kinabubuhay. And you're daily dying to yourself. And to live a Christian life, there is no one drop of easy believism sa mga sinasabi ni Jesus dito. Hindi po pwedeng that you're saved, your thinking is that you're saved, secured naman ako, and I'm satisfied. Because Jesus was speaking in very, very graphic terms here. Please note, when he says that you come after me, it's a package deal. Everyone who comes to Christ, everyone who will come after Christ. But if you're a genuine believer in Christ, you're just beginning a whole new life in which will come after Christ and follow Him for the rest of your life. Ibig sabihin po, in the moment of every day, not on Sunday morning, not just on Bible studies, but where you, when you go to work, when you go to class, kasama mo ang pamilya, you must follow the Lord Jesus Christ. It means po na you walk kung ano pong how Christ walked. He is leading you and you're just following. You're speaking kung ano yung sinasabi din ng Jesus, ni Jesus. Nagagalak ka kung ano ang kinagagalakan ni Jesus. At iyo pong nagpipighati po tayo kung ano ang mga bagay na kanya pong iniyakan. Please note in verse 27, when he says, come after me, as we come after Christ, ilalagay niya po tayo sa isang iglesia. Ilalagay niya po tayo in a ministry. At ilalagay niya po tayo to wherever He wants us to serve Him. Pero that's never a substitute for coming to Christ. This is a personal decision na kailangan po natin gawin. No one else can make that decision for you. No one else can step up and cast that decision for you. You yourself, ikaw po mismo magde-decide nito. Yung asawa mo, if he is the pastor, he cannot save you. He will not be able to save you. If leader siya ng church, if your mother, your father, or your brother is a leader of the church, a well-matured Christian believer, hindi kanya po maililigtas. Even your parents cannot do this for you. It doesn't mean that your parents are mature believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, that you as well are followers indeed of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hindi po pwedeng you put your one foot kasama ng mga lupon na mga tao and one foot that goes after Christ. It's all or nothing. You must turn and follow Christ permanently. Hindi po ito weekend trip na para po nga nagbabakasyon tayo and we just want to feel and we feel it that we want to follow Christ. This is a lifelong journey. And kailangan pong sinusunog natin yung mga tulay sa likod natin. We must follow Christ in a repentant manner. Meaning po, tinatalikuran po talaga natin yung mga bagay na pinipresenta sa atin ng mundong ito and pumunta sa bagong direksyon and to live a new life. We must follow Him obediently. Meaning po, tayo ay under the Lordship of Christ and nasa authority na po tayo ni Kristo. We must follow Christ openly. Meaning po, throughout the streets, sa ating po mga kapitbahay, whoever it is, that wherever it is that the Lord places us, in public, in our works, we must fly the flag. At kailangan po malaman ng lahat na ikaw ay tagasunod ni Kristo. We must follow Him in a comprehensive manner. Ibig sabihin po, lahat po ng area ng ating buhay in following Christ, every step of the journey is under the Lordship po ni Jesus at wala pong mga sikretong compartments na pwede po tayong ireserba sa ating pong mga sarili. Meaning, we are willing to pay the price and follow Christ. We must also follow Christ exclusively. Hindi po natin pwedeng sundan si Kristo and anyone else. Solo Kristo. Sola Cristo. Christ alone. Does this overwhelm us po, no, mga kapatid? Does this overwhelm you? This is a whole lot more than just pray this prayer with me, walk this aisle, minsan pa nga po, may sign a card, and Christian ka na. Kung ganun lang po ang Christianity, kung tutuusin po, you make more of a commitment pa nga sa iyong asawa in your marriage contract kaysa yung iyong commitment to Christ. Mas commitment pa nga po yung marriage contract rather than your commitment to Christ. In the marvelous and rich blend ng Scripture, Jesus invites us to salvation and be His disciple. Ebanghelista po si Jesus. And some people are very confused. And this has left a huge trail na of confusion to our understanding of Christianity. Yung iba po kasi, iniisip ng iba na somehow it is possible to be saved without ever really following Christ. Na posible na kilala mo si Jesus and na as a Savior but never acknowledge Him as Lord, na maliligtas ka. Na posible na manalangin lang naman ako ng isang panalangin and okay na, ibibigay sa akin ang gift of salvation with absolutely no commitment at all. Even sometimes without repentance. Ang mga mananampalataya po say here is that what it's the people who believe na, brother, ano lang naman ito, parang sinasabi ni Kristo na we just need to move up a higher level sa Christianity natin. Tumigil ka lang bilang carnal Christian, as we borrow Paul's language. At maging ano ka lang, no? Spiritual Christian. Ito po yung sinasabi nung passages na to. Hindi po. I'm sorry to say, this is not what it's saying. Kasi gagawin lang po natin na life teacher or parang coach, life coach, motivational speaker, si Jesus rather than an evangelist. Becoming a disciple of Christ ay hindi po imbitasyon na magdagdag ka lamang, magdagdag po tayo ng something sa ating buhay. Hindi po to imbitasyon na pagagandahin natin ang ating Christian life just by being obedient. Hindi po ito some kind of enrichment of otherwise our carnal Christian life. Hindi po ito emotional na makeover na kapag tinatawag po na when we call people na maging disipulo ka ni Kristo. Pero ang hindi rin po natin sinasabi na mag-move ka to a higher level of spiritual life. Ito pong pinag-uusapan ni Kristo at pinag-uusapan po natin sa araw na ito is a call to salvation. This is the rescue from hell to heaven. Hindi po ito isang parte lang na parang nadagdag lang na you just hang on to have no commitment to Christ until finally you say, I would want to commit now to Christ. And what Jesus is asking here is very and amazingly extreme. I mean the language na ating pong binasa is very extreme. That is why kailangan po natin i-count the cost muna before we start the journey. For those of us who are genuine believers in Jesus Christ, this is true for every single one of us. Wala pong exception. And there are plenty of other verses po to back this up, which should be a cause of concern for some of us who are listening today. Because you need to ask yourself, we need to ask ourselves, if we have ever become really a disciple of Christ. Totoo po ba akong believer of Jesus Christ, or I am just a part of BLCM as a crowd? Am I just part of a Bible study? O ako ba ay kumakanta lang at umaawit lang with the great music of the church in my heart of hearts? Ako ba talaga have made a commitment to Christ? And fourth, I want you to see the cost. In verse 28 to 33, or in 31 to 32, are two parables. Dalawang parables. In the first parable, it says, it will cost you everything to follow Christ. Sa second parable, it will also cost you everything if you do not follow Christ. It's going to cost you either way. So we have to choose wisely. dahil wala pong makakaalis sa mundong ito ng libre. In verse 28, it says, whoever, and Christ is looking to this enormous crowd, na kanya pong, na huminto po siya at kanya pong sinasabi, ina-address yung crowd. Which one of you, in verse 27, when he wants to build a tower, does not first sit down and calculate, o kakwentahin po natin, the cost to see if he has enough to complete it? Any wise builder po, before siya mag-uumpisa ng kanyang project, aalamin po muna niya, how much is, what is it, what is this going to cost me? I mean, it is foolish na tayo ay papasok in a building project na wala naman tayo pong idea what the cost factor is. Kung wala siya pong idea sa budget, wala siyang idea sa resources na meron siya, pero nag-skip na lang siya and made the project. Na parang sabi, it sounds like a very good idea to make a building. And let's just build. But he has no idea what it would take. Ito po ang nagre-represent to that person na sumasama lang sa crowd, sumasama lang sa pamilya during Sunday, but is never in really a disciple of Christ. In verse 29, it says, in other words, if he does not count the cost, let me make this more personal. If you do not count the cost, let me make it more personal. If I do not count the cost, it is representing po yung sumasama lang sa crowd, building up in the religious, being one in the religious scene. You know, ito yung tao na nag-raise ng hand niya, pumasok, nag-sign ng card, nagpa-baptize, join the church, sings with the music team, but we're just along for the ride of it. Kasama lang kasi nandiyan yung family niya. Sumama lang dahil nandiyan yung friends niya. Sumama lang dahil may kinahihiyaan in the crowd. There was just rushing into this, no? There was no soul searching. Walang repentance. Walang self-humiliation. Walang genuine commitment and was not able to finish. And tingnan nyo po yung verse 29. It says, they began to nakutsain siya. Of course, tama po. This should really be an object for na para kutsain talaga. That a person ay bigla na lang po papasok sa isang project and hindi pinag-isipan mabuti what it will cost you. It will cost you your old life, your old friends, your old activities, for you to be able to go in a new direction. Now, the second parable po, it will cost you if you do not follow Christ. There were two kings here na binabanggit. And itong dalawang hari na to, they have a war with each other. War with each other. They are unreconciled. One king, dinescribe dito, is God. The other king is ourselves. I'll tell you what's even more serious than just in all of this na ating pong pinag-uusapan. God is at war with sinners. I know most of you will say, alam niyo yung, I know most of you have heard the phrase na God loves the sinner but hates the sin. God loves the sinner and hates the sin. I hate to break it to you, mga kapatid. That is a false teaching, that God hates the sin, not the sinner. Remember that it is the sinner that God will send to hell. It's not the sin that God will send to, who will God will send to hell. It is the sinner. Hindi niya, hindi po ang sin ang dadalhin, ang ilalagay ni Kristo sa impyerno, kundi yung tao who is sinning. And we say that God loves the sinner rather than the sin. God is at war with sinners. It is far more than just to begin the story and smile and says, Jesus loves you and offers a wonderful plan in your life. Hindi pa nga po yan nagsiscratch ng surface what the gospel is. There are sinners in the hands of an angry God. The conflict of war is in place if you do not humble yourself and say, and do not count the cost of following Christ. And now, what we see here is that umupo bigla itong tao na to. And he tried to consider, do I have what it takes to battle with this king na may 20,000 tao na ang dala-dala ko lamang 10,000? He understands, I cannot meet this king in battle. Dahil wawasakin niya ako. Pupuksain niya ako. At parurusahan niya ako magpakailanman. So the sensible option for any thinking person is that you prepare. While the other one is far away, before Christ comebacks, before we meet Him face to face, we must submit to the terms of peace. And God sends a delegation dito, no? He sends someone to represent Him. There is only one person who can make peace between God and sinners, and it's the Lord Jesus Christ. Ano po yung terms of peace? Ano po yung dinadala ni Kristo dito na terms of peace? Here is the things to call off the war between God and you. You must hate your own father, brother, sister, and even your own life. You must come to Christ. You must take up the cross and die to self. This is authentic na saving faith. Anything less than this standard. And let's not justify ourselves and say, God will understand me. Anything less than this standard of hating your own father, mother, brother, sister, hating your own life, and coming to Christ and taking up the cross and die to self. Anything less than this standard keeps us at war with God. We are at war with the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And when He comes back, you will meet Him as an angry king towards rebels, towards criminals, and against His kingdom. For those who refuse na magpakumbaba, lumuhod kay Kristo and accept these gracious terms of peace from Him, you'll still be at war with God. The terms of peace are found in the gospel of Jesus Christ. That He has come into this world, no? Born of a virgin, mamumuhay ng sinless and perpekto na buhay, pupunta sa krus ng Kalbaryo at mamamatay for our place. And siya po ay babangon ng muli, mabubuhay at aascend at pupunta po ng langit to the right sa kanang kamay ng Diyos and offer free salvation. But it will cost you everything to receive. And verse 33, which really is putting the bottom line in all of this. There is no exceptions. None of you can be my disciple. And Christ puts it again in the negative to make it somewhat challenging and also difficult to come to Him and follow Him. So that none of you can be my disciples who does not give up all his own possessions. Ano po ibig sabihin ito? I mean, does this mean that ililiquidate ko na po lahat ng assets ko? Ibebenta ko na po lahat sa garage sale? Ililista ko na po ba ang lahat sa mga online shops? Uubusin ko na po ba yung bank account ko at ipamigay ko na lang sa mga nangangailangan in order to enter the kingdom of heaven? No. Don't do that. Does this mean that you have to buy salvation? No, of course not. No, salvation is a free gift of God. So what does this mean? This means when you become a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, all that you are, all that you have, ay transferred na to Him. Your time, your gift, yung impluensya, yung talento, lahat ng kung sino ka ay nasa Diyos na, nasa kay Kristo na, because binili niya, or He bought the whole package. He bought everything about you. And this is what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. You're no longer an owner. You're now a steward. Tagapangalaga ka na lamang po niyan. And pinapangalagaan niyo po what belongs to Jesus Christ. And you have to invest these things and use them accordingly in a way and in a manner na magdadala ng higit na luwalhati kay Jesus. Or else, you cannot be His disciple. So finally, tingnan po natin yung paalala in verse 37. And again, if I was preaching this, and if I was someone else no preaching this, if someone else was preaching this, we would say, no, brother, kailangan mo naman magbigyan mo naman hangin ng konti para huminga those who are listening. And you've got to be nicer now. But let's observe, Jesus goes much deeper here and goes for the jugular. Dahil po adult conversation ito. He is not factoring this down to a little seeker-sensitive na serbisyo. Katotohanan po ang kanyang sinasabi. And notice in verse 34 and 35, therefore, salt is good. Christ is painting pictures in our mind. And yes, salt is good. For sure po, no, gumamit kayo ng asin this morning for breakfast. It's good. Preserves meat against preserves meat and prevents it from spoiling para hindi po mabulok. But if salt has become tasteless now, and real salt does not become tasteless, false salt becomes tasteless. He's now pictured the person who is building the project but could not finish the project ay now pinipicture to become salt who has lost its flavor. How can a tasteless salt bring back its flavor? The answer is to only turn to Christ. Commit to Christ. Because as long as this person remains na parang tao lang who was in the crowd na sumasabay lamang sa agos, it's just tasteless salt. Use this in verse 35, it refers to a tasteless salt na parang degrading term pa nga pong ginagamit. It's like saying na you're just good for nothing. Now, there is no redemptive value to your life whatsoever. In fact po, sagabal ka nga lang po kung tutuusin. Dahil useless ka either way. Hindi ka na pwedeng gamitin as a fertilizer, but you're also tasteless. But notice here, and I have to excuse myself for the words that I will be using. I hope you're not eating because you're not supposed to. Or for the manure pile. I wouldn't even say this except Jesus said it from His own lips. And He again intended to do so for shock value. If you haven't genuinely made the commitment to Christ, your life is not even good enough para malamangan mo yung amoy ng dumi. It's pretty graphic because you're just a good for nothing half-committed followers of Christ are not followers of Christ. Let me repeat that. Half-committed followers of Christ are not followers of Christ. You may be someone in this world na naririnig yung applause ng inyong mga katrabaho. Nagkakaroon ka ng awards left and right in the corporate world, in your school. Naririnig mo yung palakpak ng iyong mga kaibigan. Naririnig mo yung palakpak ng even your own family. But half commitment to Christ, half commitment to a holy God, you're just worse than a manure pile. Ibig sabihin, mas malala ka pa sa dumi. You're not even good enough para malamangan mo ang amoy ng dumi. Wala kang impluensya, you have no real influence, wala kang witness. In fact, your testimony is a dead testimony. And you're worse than the stench of the manure pile, ng dumi. This is the extreme character of discipleship. And the language of God is unmistaken, absolute po to, and it's very well defined and severe. Pero hindi po ako yung nagsasalita dito, but it's God Himself who is speaking. Siya ang mag-establish ng standards for discipleship. Siya ang magdedetermina ng karakter ng totoong pagsisisi and saving faith. And when you study the words of Jesus, He's not making it easy. And He's making it actually virtually impossible sa isip nating mga tao. Dahil alam niyo po kung bakit? Napakagaling po kasi ng kultura nating na tao to make things easy. Sabi nga po lagi, no? Isimplify mo. Making it as easy as possible. And this culture finds its way even sa loob ng iglesia. This is not what Jesus did. And here's the punchline. Hindi po ito binago ni Kristo over the years. It applies back then. It applies now. The cost of discipleship will never have a version 2. Balikan po natin yung scene here and we're about finished. Christ, after nagsalita niya po siya sa crowd na ito, many of the crowd left. Hindi po natin alam kung ilan na natira after God is speaking all of these things. But there were at least 11 na kilala natin. 11 persons na natira dun sa crowd na yon who would later testify in life. They will testify, no, to the cost of following Christ. Let me tell you their story one by one with one words each. Peter, ipinako sa krus ng baliktad. Andrew, ipinako sa krus na X, letter X, ang shape. James, pinagsasaksak. John, sinubukan siyang lutuin ng buhay sa isang drum of oil. But he survived and died of an old age after being exiled in Patmos. Philip, ipinako sa krus ng mga soldiers. Bartholomew, binalatan ng buhay at pinugutan ng ulo. Matthew, pinagsasaksak. James, pinagbabato at ipinako sa krus. Simon, ipinako sa krus. Jude, pinagsasaksak. And then Jesus ends by saying, He who has an ear, let him hear. In other words po, nakikinig po ba tayo? And are we paying attention? Ina-examine po ba natin ang ating sarili? Ina-audit po ba natin ang sarili nating kaluluwa? Have you counted the cost? Do you know what it means to be a follower of Christ, makinig ang may pandinig. Someone has written a poem, and I just took the time and liberty to change it to a Filipino version. And it's entitled sa English, I am a disciple of Christ. Ako ay disipulo ni Kristo. Let me just read it to you. Ako ay disipulo ni Kristo. Nailatag na ang lahat at humakbang na ako sa linya at ako ay disipulo na ni Kristo. Hindi ako titingin sa iba, hihinto, babagal, aatras o walang kibo. Hindi ko kailangan ang karangalan, karangyaan, posisyon, promosyon, palakpak o katanyagan. Hindi ako kailangang mauna, magkaroon ng makilala, mapuri, pahalagahan o gantimpalaan. Ang lakarin ko ay malinaw at mabilis, at ang tunguhin ko ay langit. Ang daan ay makitid, ang daan ay puno ng lubak. Ang mga sumasama sa akin ay kakaunti, ngunit ang gabay ko ay maaasahan. Ang misyon ko ay maliwanag. Hindi ako mabibili, makukompromiso man lang, mapipigilan, maaakit, babalik, palilin lang o maaantala. Hindi ako makikipagkasundo sa mesa ng kalaban. Hindi ko pagninilayan ang lawa ng popularidad. Hindi ako magpapaikot-ikot sa kalituhan ng mga bagay na walang kabuluhan. Hindi ako susuko, aatras o tatahimik hanggat sa ating maipanalangin, maipangaral at maimbak ang layunin ni Kristo. Tutuloy ako hanggat siya'y bumalik. Ibibigay ko ang lahat hanggat ako ay bumagsak. Ipapangaral ko ang lahat hanggat alam ng lahat. Tuloy ang gawain hanggat siya ay bumalik at sa kanyang pagbabalik upang kuhanin ang mga nasa kanya. Walang pag-aaninlangan, walang duda na ako ay kanyang makikilala. Ang kulay ko at watawat ay magiging malinaw na ako ay disipulo ni Kristo. The question is, tayo ba ay disipulo ni Jesus? Kung tayo po ay disipulo ni Jesus, ito pong umaga nito is a reminder kung ano po ba ang pinasok natin na ito. This is Christianity 101. Basic Christianity. Entry level Christianity. At kapag hindi nyo pa po kinumit ang inyong buhay, hindi pa po natin kinumit ang ating buhay kay Kristo, maybe as you find yourself here today, na may conflict pa po sa inyong utak, kung ano pong parang naglalaban sa inyong utak, maybe even as I have gone through these verses, at patapos na po tayo, and there's some pushback sa inyo. I mean, obviously, no? This preacher right here is preaching his first sermon at 27 years old. At doble pa nga po ng edad ko itong nagsasalita na ito. And he's telling me already how I should live my life? Yes, brethren. That's what exactly I'm doing. It doesn't matter who I am. What matters is, this is the Word of God and it's telling us what we need to do and where you're going. These are the words of Jesus Christ. And perhaps today, the Lord is waking you up. Perhaps may feeling of uneasiness within you that is beginning to convict you of your sin. At tinatanggalan ka na po o tinatanggalan na po tayo ng maskara because of our lack of genuine faith and commitment to the Lord. And if that's so, I am so thankful to the Lord. Nagpapasalamat ako sa Diyos na dinala ka po ngayon dito. I'm thankful that the Lord has brought you here today so that sa probidensya ng ating Panginoon, you would hear this message of how good of a God, how merciful of a God He is to come up to you and parang sinishake na po tayo by our shoulders and say, wake up. And if that is where you are today, I want to encourage you. He says, whoever, his arms are open wide, He is calling you right now, calling you out of the crowd, bidding you na pumunta ka sa Kanya. You who is weary and heavy laden, and He will give you rest. That's a good deal, kaibigan. You are giving up your heavy burden of sin to receive yung yoke of Christ. And He gets in that yoke with you. He removes the guilt of your sin. And some people will say, well, it's hard to be a Christian. I want you to know, kapatid, it's even harder to be a sinner. The wages of the sin is death. The way of the transgressor is hard. It's a glorious thing to be a follower of Jesus Christ. And there's no way we could have this many people na nakikinig po ngayon in our Zoom virtual service. And for all of us to be a genuine believer in Jesus Christ. Jesus had 12 disciples. 11 of them were believers and one was not. He had crowds with Him. Hundreds of them were not genuine believers in Christ. Please know, mga kapatid, that I am not foolish or naive enough to think. And I hope you're not also being naive or foolish about yourselves. To think that all of you here who are listening are genuine believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. There are you in our group today, there are those who are not genuine believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. Please know that I am not also naive to think that whatever happened when you were 6 years old, 7 years old, or you went to some youth camp that might not have been real and genuine. If you come to faith in Christ today, the Lord is calling you as an adult. Come all the way to Him and He will receive sinners. He comes to seek the save and to save which is lost. Tell Him how sick you are. Tell Him how desperately you need Him in your life. Tell Him what a sinner you are. He didn't die for good people. He died for bad people. He died for sinners. And He will snatch you out from the darkness and bring you into the light. And you will begin this whole new life journey. Following after Christ. And you'll no longer be at war with Christ. And you will also be a joint heir with Him. And one day, when you die, or when He comes back, He will take you to glory. You will be with His Father forever and ever. This is the greatest offer that has been made in the history of the world. Imaginin po ninyo, you're giving up yung inyong alikabok na buhay for the diamonds for everlasting life. Alikabok na buhay ang iyong gini-give up. You give up your sin, yourself, your possessions, everything for salvation. And it's a free offer. Salvation, it's a free offer. Just remember, though it's free, it will cost you. But by His grace, He will enable you to be faithful in every sacrifice and the demands of Christ every moment of your life. The call today is the day of salvation. If you hear this, please, I pray, don't harden your heart. Boast not of yourself of tomorrow. For you know not what a day may bring forth. You may be even not here in this world tomorrow. Believe in Christ this moment. Please decide. But remember, count the cost. Because it will cost you everything. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for your word today. We thank you, Lord, for giving us the time, the chance to look at your word. May we be challenged, Lord, and continue to look at the commitment that we have to Christ as a church, as individuals. And Lord, though this preaching, Lord, was quite lengthy, I pray, Lord, that it would just start something, Lord, or start everything, Lord, for year 26 and onwards for the church's life. May we not, Lord, be fooled by the enemy of half commitment to Christ, but may we give everything, Lord, that we have for the glory and for the continual life po na meron kami po, Panginoon, in this world. May we be ready for persecution, for hardships. And Lord, I just pray that in this life, Lord, may we always, Lord, put into our hearts that you are with us every step of the way, and put our commitment, Lord, and stay away, Lord, from the deceiving schemes of the enemy. Lord, this is our 25th anniversary, but I pray, Lord, that may we continue to praise you and glorify your name in our lives as we celebrate today. But Lord, more than the celebration, may you just, Lord, call new believers in our midst today. And Lord, may the Holy Spirit bless us and continue to grace us with your loving kindness, mercy, and comforts, and keep us safe, Lord, throughout this week. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen.